Don't worry. Don't worry. We're getting there. We're getting there. Okay? No matter what I say, one way or the other, we are getting there. We're closing in. So we just have to continue to our discipline of full stop and the wow, which is what enable us to handle great good news, super great news, super great news. Very shortly, it's likely that we will get the boost that we need. Very likely. And the only way to benefit from this, really benefit, is to be able to practice full stop in the wow, where you intentionally just go into neutral. Okay. Now you might think, well, I'm not benefiting from it. I need to engage with it. I need to dialogue. No. No. The good news is so great, it transcends intellect. It transcends words. You know, there's something in you that knows. And you have to realize this, we have to realize this and say, wow, this is it. And I need to handle the shock of this. I need to, so preemptively, with will and clarity, you say, oh, I know how to do this. I know how to practice this. So I will do that. And you just be quiet. Just be quiet. And I would say, as the big boost gets here, is there's not going to be any talk, there's not going to be any dialogue, there's not going to be questions and answers, there's not going to be any interviews, there's not going to be any of that. Just sit and be quiet. Just sit and be quiet. Because you'll know. You'll know. You will know. Something in you will know. And instead of just like kind of indulging in the, oh, you're like deer in headlights. No, we immediately say, oh, okay, we expected this. We know the practice to use. It's full stop in the wow. So I'm just going to trust in that. I'm good at it. And that's what I'm going to do. Just be quiet. Just be still. Just be quiet. And accept the wow. The wow will be there. This is how we do it. This is how it goes. There's no question that we need a big boost now. There is no question about it. And like I said, we're very liable to get it. I was told 215 way back in like 2004. I was told 215, but I said, that's impossible. I can never last this long. No way. I was so burned out from this life that just to think that I'd have to hang around for 11 more years, I thought it was totally impossible. Not a chance I could do that. So I just dismissed. I said, well, that can't be true. It can't be 215. But here we are. You know, somehow, through the grace of God, that is just, I don't even know how I did it. I'm still here. 215 is very likely when we get the big boost. And so we have been preparing for it for the first half of 215. And I've been saying all along that the second half of 215 into the first half of 216 is when the turmoil is really going, but when the bar fight, that's when the bar fight breaks out, the full-on bar fight. You know, you see in a Western movie, you have the various stuff in the movie, and it's all leading to the bar fight. You know it is. There's various conflicts and things that arise and gunfights and everything. But at some point, you know that all the characters are going to be in the bar and all heck is going to break loose. And this is going to be a free-for-all. I mean, you know, it's a free-for-all. And so that is now what the second half of 215 is going to be, a free-for-all. All heck is going to break loose. And it certainly is. It most certainly is. So we should expect the big boost, as I've been saying for so long, that there's likely to be a big boost in some way. And we've prepared for it. Full stop on the wow is preparing for it. That's how to prepare for it. So if for example, just use an example, let's say Jesus was here. We were aware of it. Oh, Jesus is right here, or something like that. To use an example, what we do is, oh, hey, I started thinking about, gee, what do I need to ask Jesus? How is this going to work out for me? No, we wouldn't do any of that, would we? We wouldn't do that at all. We immediately recognize the situation. A wow trigger is here. Okay, this is a wow trigger. I know this is triggering a wow, and it's going to trigger a very intense wow. So right away, I sit down, I'm quiet, I'm still, and I go right into spiritual practice, full stop in the wow practice. So this is I am now. This is I am now. This is I am now. We use assertions, we use full stop in the wow, we use flipping the script. But most importantly, we use full stop in the wow. And that is we remain very quiet, remain still, quiet, not going anywhere, not planning to go anywhere, not thinking about anything, just neutral. We go into neutral mode. And this way we absorb the shock of this positive element that has arisen. This drastically alters our expectations. The entire landscape of our expectations has just shifted and in such an immeasurable way. So really, the wow is really something that is immeasurable, and we must not try to measure it. We must not try to measure it. This is what I mean, full stop in the wow. Take no measure. Take no measure of it. Do not try to measure it. If we start trying to measure it, like, oh, Jesus is here. Okay, let me try to measure this situation. How's it going to go? Let me measure my expectations, measure what's going to happen, measure, measure, measure. This is when we come unglued. Our mind comes unglued. We won't be able to sleep. We'll have a nervous breakdown, actually. You cannot measure the immeasurable. So you must go into this discipline of not taking measure, not calculating, not taking measure. This is a discipline. This is a spiritual discipline. This is the key spiritual discipline. You can have all the others. If you don't have this one, how can you succeed? You must have this key discipline. Do not take any measure. Guard against it. Guard against it. Do not advance, do not retreat, do not advance, do not retreat. We've always heard the saying, good things come to them who wait. Well, perfect things, perfection comes to those who prepare, practice full stop in the wow. Perfection comes to those who practice full stop in the wow. So you can easily know, are you ready? Are you an expert at full stop in the wow? Have you become really expert at it? Which I've been urging everybody to do so. Because when you have a perfection arrive on the scene, you cannot try to take the measure of it. That will cause the unraveling of you come unglued, you'll come unraveled, it won't work for you. You become troublesome then. You become acting out. You become a distraction. You know, you just, you can't hang on to it. You can't grip it. You cannot, you know, it's because you're trying to measure what is immeasurable. And you get all these false measurements. Say, maybe it's this, maybe it's that. Doesn't work. Slips through your fingers. It's like pouring water into a glass that has holes in the bottom. You keep pouring, it doesn't fill up. You say, what's the matter? Because you're trying to take measure. Every time you try to take measure, it's like poking a hole in the bottom of your glass. So we must continue to stress what is important here. What is crucially important, and it has to get through to some in this world. I mean, it seemed like we're not doing anything. What are we doing? Just sitting quiet, sitting still. Remember, this is not just sitting quiet and trying to be quiet our mind or something. It's more than that. It's determination to take no measure. It's willful. Your mind is focused. Your mind is on guard. You know, it's saying, I'm not going to allow this fear to try to take measure of perfection. I'm not going to allow the ego to try and measure perfection as if it were just another sacrificial symbol in the dream of sacrifice, trying to get rid of guilt, non-existent guilt. I said, no, this is something different. This is not part of the dream of guilt. So don't try to measure it mentally, emotionally, intellectually, physically, in any way. Don't try to measure it in any way. I'm just neutral. I'm just coasting here. I'm just not labeling, not defining. See, that's a measurement. Don't define, don't label. Don't construct. Just let it be. Now, this seems like a tall task. It is, but it's not an impossible task. It's just a matter of practicing us all. It's a skill that you can, you know, really acquire. And people are acquiring skills all the time in this world, but this is a skill. This is the most valuable skill there is, without any question. In my mind, this is the most valuable skill there is. So this is what I turn people to. I've always tried to give people the very best that I was aware of, whether it's this life or previous lives. I tried to say, look, this is the best that I can come up with. And so here it is. And so this is the best that I can come up with. For me, it's the most valuable skill there is. Nothing even comes close to it. Nothing comes close. Take no measure. Full stop in the wow. Again, it's not just silence. It's there's a wow. We can feel the wow factor. We could feel it. It's close. We really can feel it right now, can't we? We know the bar fight has started. You know, the part of the movie is the end of the movie. When the bar fight starts, it's the end of the movie. So, we know. This is when all the characters show up. You know, all the threads in the movie are now woven together and there's a resolution. Some resolution takes place. At least that option is available. Keep in mind that trying to expiate and atone for an imaginary guilt, that never reaches any resolution. In fact, nothing is resolved. The truth is that karma is never resolved. In this dream of death, nothing is ever resolved. We think death resolves the force. It doesn't. Not at all. I discovered that in 1978, where I spontaneously remembered all my previous lives. And this resulted ultimately in me realizing death doesn't resolve anything. I still had all the same traits as my previous life. I had all the same traits. Nothing had been resolved. And there was no maybe about it, because my previous life, the one just previous to this, 19th century, this was someone that it was very industrious and talented and left a mark upon the world. And people wrote about this person. You know, there's a life of interest, to put it this way. And so I was able to go back and study, you know, this life. And I was able to see and determine without any doubt about it that all of the the total complex that was this person. I had the exact same complex. There's no difference at all. I hadn't resolved anything by dying. And the in-between life hadn't resolved anything either. I was the exact same personality. Everything was the same. And it's like, we think that maybe, some people think that after we die, we go in the afterlife and that resolves stuff. Well, it doesn't. It's more similar to like taking a vacation away. Let's say you live in a place with all these problems and stresses and stuff. You say, well, I just got to get away from this. You know, let's go to Hawaii. So you spend like 10 days in Hawaii and you're just, you know, lounging by the pools, swaying in a hammock under palm trees by the beach. You know, you're just relaxing. You think this is so great. And then eventually you have to get up on that plane and go back home. And when you get back home, all the problems are still there. You gradually realize, oh my gosh, the bills, the hassle with people, trying to earn money, the kids, you know, they've got problems. All the same, all the whole thing is still there. You say, oh my gosh, I thought I had escaped it. Did not. So the afterlife is like this. You spend like it's a vacation, but then you come back and you realize you have the same problems that you always had. Nothing is resolved. Now don't worry, there is an answer for this. But death is not the answer. And this is what I realized. My world was completely turned upside down in 1978. Irretrievably, I lost the innocence, the bliss of innocence, so to speak, which is not real bliss at all. But just thinking, well, maybe when I die, my problems are going to be gone. Maybe, you know. I knew 100% for sure that death does not solve our problems. And I could never go back to that maybe-ness. Never. There's no way to go back to it. And so I became super desperate from that point on, super desperate. And it's been 38 years of just all-out desperate effort, which leads to, you know, right now, where the answer is coming into focus. And the answer is so tremendous. I mean, just imagine that you've been stuck in this situation where you feel, you know, that death doesn't resolve your problems. And you can't find out what else is there. How, you know, you don't know, so you're desperate. And gradually coming into view, you see, there is a way. You know, I thought, maybe there's no way at all. And then you gradually start thinking, maybe there's a way. This is very good news to you to hear this, to a desperate person who thinks they're going to be stuck with, that nothing is ever going to be resolved for them, to start to gradually realize, hey, there is a way to get, there is something. I don't know exactly what it is. And of course, we do know what this is now. To have that come into view, you know, this is like the best news possible. It is the best possible news. And this shocks us. This shocks us. We're shocked by it. It's not the Shakti that's shocking us. It is the great good news that we're not bound by the Shakti. We're not bound by the world. We're not bound by this dream. We don't have to get free of the dream, so to speak. We don't have to, you know, resolve anything. We just realize there's never any necessity to it whatsoever. It's meaningless. It's nothing. It's nothing at all. Nothing ever happened. I don't need to get rid of guilt. I don't need to get free of guilt because there is no guilt. So it's not like we figure out how to get free of guilt. That never happens. So as long as we're trying for a resolution, meaning trying to get free of guilt, resolve this, it's impossible. It's impossible. It doesn't happen. But when we recognize that guilt is just a lie, it's an invention that doesn't exist. It's nothing at all. Then obviously there's no reason to atone for it. There's no reason to try to get rid of it. There's no reason to try to get free of it. This is very different than what we're used to. And that is like this complete, everless resolving. The whole thing is resolved as one. So there isn't any, you know, resolution of individual karma or individual like that. You know, the whole thing is resolved as one. It was never necessary at all. I never had any karma, actually. Karma doesn't exist, actually. It's never existed. personality traits actually don't exist. They've never really existed. Everything that I've been thinking I need to resolve has never really existed at all. There's never been any momentum to it. Nothing, nothing, nothing whatsoever. So it's quite different than the type of resolution that we're trying, have been trying to reach, you see. It's very, very other than that. I don't need any success because there's nothing to be successful in relation to. I mean, I don't need to be to successfully get free of guilt because there isn't any guilt. So ultimately, it's a feeling I don't need to do anything. I realize I don't need to do anything. I never needed to do anything. And I've never done anything, actually. It's like that. This is called non-dual abidance. Duality is, of course, problem-solution. That's duality. That I'm not okay now, but the next moment I will be okay. This assumes a resolution of some sort. This is duality. It's not just now, it's now and the next moment. Now things are not right, next moment we expect them to be right. That is duality. This is our trouble. It's simply, we realize, no, everything is perfect now. This is I am now. Everything is perfect now, right now. There's nothing I need to do to change now, or to escape now, or do anything with now. This is not a resolution of anything. It's just a statement of fact. So it's not really a resolution. Enlightenment is not a resolution of anything. Non-dual bite is not, nothing's resolved at all. It's you realize you don't need any resolution. Nothing has ever happened that needs to be resolved. Guilt never happened. Guilt never happened because we didn't change the will of God at all. We failed to change the will of God, and we misinterpreted this failure willfully, arrogantly, as guilt. As saying, oh yeah, we did change God, or we got killed. Changing God would mean destroying God. And we did succeed, but this feeling we have now is guilt about it. We feel, oh gee, sorry, you know, I feel bad about that, but nothing I can do about it now. So, and then we think we need to get rid of, resolve this guilt, you know, so we're working to resolve the guilt. This is just completely made up. There isn't any guilt. There isn't any success of changing God. It's just complete failure. We didn't do it. It's impossible. Just like the instant of trying to change God and the fact that of the impossibility of it are simultaneous. They're concurrent. So there's only one instant. The whole issue of our arrogance and our whim only was one instant. The attempt to change God and the realization we can't change God was simultaneous in one instant, and that's all there was to it. It wasn't. They're not two instances. They're not two instants at all. There's not. It's not like we tried to change God in one, you know, one instant, and then the next instant. You know, the next instant, we realized we couldn't. Well, what was in between those instants, so to speak? No. You see, that brings up, you know, time. That brings up guilt, the supposed guilt. That's duality. This instant and then this instant somehow are joined. That's where we came up with the idea of guilt. It didn't happen that way. The problem resolution was all in the same instant, really. The impossibility of changing God is right now. It's not in the next instant, it's right now. And as soon as we thought, believed that the situation was in the next instant, that's when we then believed in guilt and atoning for guilt. It's not true. It's not true at all. We just made it up. Now, you can follow all sorts of idols of success and all this, but if you can't do full stop on the wow, how are you going to realize the great good news? That there's nothing you need to do. Never has been anything that you needed to do at all to be exactly perfect as you are right now. You don't need the next instant in relation to now. You don't need anything in relation to now. Now is its own perfect relationship. It's always simultaneous. It's always spontaneous. There isn't any lack of perfect spontaneity in reality at all. Every moment is spontaneously free. The idea that it wasn't, that was just one moment, not two. It was just one moment. Failed, change of reality is a failure from the get-go. It wasn't like the first moment we're changing reality and the second moment we realize failure. No. What happened in between? There is no in-between. There is no in-between. The idea of changing reality is a failure this very instant. The instant we think of it is intrinsically a failure. It's not that we have to then take thought to realize it's a failure. It's a failure from the get-go. It wasn't like, we didn't realize it was a failure, and now we realize it's a failure. We need to realize that. No, it's intrinsically a failure. That very instant, it's a failure. There's not two instants involved. Just one. This is super important to hear this. And of course, this brings a great wow with it. Like, wow, this is really vitally important to see this, recognize this, to hear this, to consider this, to accept it. It's not easy to say this. I tried out two videos before this, and neither one of them worked really. I just couldn't quite get to it, I was dancing around it. It's too much. I said, "No, this isn't going to work. We can't just dance around it here at this right now. That's not going to work. We have to get to it. And it's going to, of course, it produces a wow right now. It's producing a wow. To get to it, to this, clarity, and to this extent, like this atomistic extent almost, right? Use a symbol where it's just fundamental. It's so fundamental. There wasn't two instants. There was just one. The thought and the failure of the thought are really one and the same. The thought of changing God is a failure thought. It's not like we had the thought of God. Yeah, maybe we can change God. Then, oh, I found out we can't. It's not like that. The thought of changing God is a failure thought from the get-go. There's no wiggle room at all. So this is bringing up a wow. It's pushing things, which we need to do right now. I mean, there's this gigantic bar fight going on in the world. I mean, and it's just going to, people will be coming from all over into the bars. Hey, look at this fight going on. Wow. And they'll get pulled into it. Everybody's going to get pulled into it. And before you know it, everybody's swinging, haymakers, throwing bottles. And so we don't want to get pulled into it. So we have to bring the big boost into the situation some way, somehow. And full stop on the wow is essential. Absolutely essential. So we have to keep practicing it. As much as we would like to be lazy, it doesn't work that way. Take no measure. Take no measure of this. It's not like we had the idea of changing God. So, well, let me measure this. Let me say, oh, I measured it, and it turns out that I don't think I can do it. No, it wasn't like that. There's no measuring of it. It's intrinsically impossible. Instead, we said, no, it's we did it, but it's guilt. Let's measure the guilt here. Let's measure the guilt. Take measure of the guilt. And then help them be able to figure out how to get free of this guilt. As if something happened. As if one moment led to the next. See, the attempt to change reality led to the next moment of guilt. That is not true. That is not true. We simply imagined that it did. Arrogantly, you know, insisted on it. Guilt is just made up. It's a fantasy. And atoning for guilt is a dream of, it's a fantasy. It's a dream of death. The universal dream of sacrificial death, you know, is an attempt to get rid of this fantasy guilt, which is our way of entertaining the idea of that we can change God. It's the only way to entertain the idea, actually. We all know that something's wrong, you know, with this body life. No matter what we do, it's never right, is it? It's never right the way we really want it to be right. Nobody feels that way, do they? Always feel, you know, it's maybe this is okay, kind of nice, but it's still missing something. It's just, I'm missing something. Something's unresolved, you know, I can't put my finger on what it is, but there's just sort of this deep, vague dissatisfaction, you know, I feel, and can't get rid of it. You look at everybody, no matter how successful they've been, or unsuccessful, or whatever walk of life, you recognize it in their eyes, and their demeanor, that there's this doubt in their mind, it's like, I didn't quite find it. I haven't quite found it. Maybe people think I have, but I know I really haven't. Something still isn't right. You know, why did I miss it? You know, I'm not sure how I missed it. I tried hard to find it, but I didn't find it. No matter how people try to live their lives, you look at them and you can see that there's still something unresolved in their minds, right? There's a feeling of something is unresolved. Can't get rid of it, right? The answer is that there's nothing to resolve. See, instead of trying to resolve something, you take the position that there's nothing to resolve. So I don't have this problem of I haven't found the resolution yet. There is no resolution to what doesn't exist. So we are continuing to press this and practice full stop in the wow here. Got to. I didn't watch the news today. As I said, I would not. I didn't. I don't know what's going on in the world today. You know, more bar fight, I'm sure. You could say that every day. I don't think you have to look at the news anymore, you know. Yeah, I hear about the news. Oh, yeah, more bar fight today. Sure, there's more bar fight. Yeah, some of this happens. Yeah, more bar fight. Absolutely, there's more bar fight today. That pretty much encapsulates it. Yeah, somebody got hit over the head with a bottle, and somebody got punched, you know, this way, and somebody got thrown onto a table, and somebody got kicked, and oh yeah, right, there's more bar fight today, for sure. More bar fight today. So you just wrap it up. You know, I'll give you the news every day, folks. Welcome to the news. And say, well, today, there was more bar fight today. And that concludes our nightly news. Just keep it simple. Keep it simple. any measure. Don't try to measure perfection. Don't try to measure now. There's no measurement of now. It's always now. How can we measure that? What is always? It's always now. How can we measure that? Take no measurement. Take no thought. Take no measurement. Thought is measurement. Definition. Take no definition. Take no measurement. Full stop in the wow. We don't have to measure the bar fight, see? We don't have to take measure of the bar fight. I ditched my comb over. That means I'm dropping out of the race. I will not be a candidate in the presidential contest. I will not be running. Don't put my name on the ballot. Don't write my name in on the ballot. Don't waste your vote. I am not running. I realize that I can never achieve the proper comb over. Just don't have it. Just don't have it. Just don't have the right kind of swagger for that. Actually, it's below my pay grade. You know, I just can't do it. It's below my pay grade. So, cannot do that. But we can practice full stop in the wow. Got that lovely cricket helping us out. Can't have better music than that. Cool, cloudy day in California. And they tell us El Nino's gonna coming. I did hear that. You know, El Nino. Biggest El Nino on record brewing. And so, you know, could be a drought buster this winter. Well, we've heard that before. That's a way to get ratings, isn't it? Telling me, yeah, it looks like the drought might be over this winter. We're not getting our hopes up. I haven't washed my vehicle in a year, actually. There's still crickets are still around. That's good. Cloudy, cool day in California. As we just allow the wow to absorb what we've heard. Keep in mind that when you know what we've been looking at is extremely intense, shockingly great news. I mean, in your spirit, you know, it's like resuscitation, spiritual resuscitation. You thought you were dead, and now you're coming back to life. Say, I'm not. I thought I was dead. I'm not dead. I thought I was dead, and I had to come back to life. I was never dead. The resurrection isn't a resurrection from death. It's a resurrection you don't need death. You never died. You don't need to atone for anything. That's the only way to be resurrected. The resurrection is really the disappearance, the realization you were never dead. You were never born. You never died. Nothing ever happened. And And hearing this, you know, it strikes a chord within us. You know, this is more, you can never strike a chord like this in music. You can never do it. I don't care where you are. You can never strike a chord this strong. People get very angry if you point out this. They're saying, "What do you mean? I've lived this life in vain. This is a very important life for me. I need to make a lot of success. I got to resolve stuff. I mean, this is my life's important, is it?" No, none of this is important. We cannot look at it individually as if it's all these individuals. We're talking about the total situation. None of it's important. None of it. It's all a dream, all of it. Set it down, all is one. Set all that imaginary karma down, all is one. No one has any karma. No one ever generated any karma whatsoever. It's all a dream. Based on the false, arrogant lie of guilt. Based on the belief that one moment we had this idea of changing reality, and then the next moment we felt guilt about it. That is not true. The idea of changing reality is inherently impossible, and we felt the failure of it concurrently. We didn't have an instant where we felt it, and went, "Oh, this is fine." And the next moment we felt, "Oh, this is impossible." No, it didn't work that way. It can never work that way. You can never have an instant where we experienced the desire to change reality, where we experienced that desire without the feeling that it was impossible. There can never be an instant like that. So we think there was cause and effect happened one moment, and the next moment was the effect. "Oh, I feel guilt about it." That is not true. It's absolutely not true. Had a great dinner tonight, kept it simple. It is July after all. We're in the middle of summer. So, veggie hot dog. Bottle of mango lemonade. And Neapolitan ice cream. How could it be any simpler than that? Right? Hot dog, mango lemonade, Neapolitan ice cream. Call it good. Very satisfying. Not too heavy of a meal. Yeah, veggie hot dogs they have now are very, the ones I have, very good. What, Morningstar, I think it's called, by Kellogg. Tastes like a hot dog. It's great. You throw the mayonnaise, the mustard, the ketchup. Some people say you can't put ketchup on a hot dog. Yeah, okay, I understand, I put ketchup on it. Lettuce and onions and cheese, shredded cheese, and relish, and some green Tabasco sauce, with a little spice into it. Wonderful hot dog, and some extra large rainbow buns, R-A-A-I-N-B-O, rainbow buns. Extra long, and it's fabulous, fabulous. Hubert's, what is this? H-U-B-E-R-T, Hubert's mango lemonade. Very good, very refreshing drink. And then some good old Breyers Neapolitan ice cream. The perfect summer meal. Stayed away from, you know, the macaroni salad and the potatoes. That's what has weight. You know, that, you start getting into those cold salads, and you're in trouble, along with the chips and dip. You know, if you go chips and dip, macaroni salad, potato salad, and add that onto the hot dog and everything else, then too much. It's too much. And the baked beans. I mean, a hot dog is not that many calories. You just got the bun, and these are the veggie hot dogs. Are not many calories. And a few condiments, and that's it. That's it. So it's not a heavy meal. It's good to go to bed a little hungry. It's great. So we're just in the, full stop in the wow phase here. Just prattling on a little bit as we, allow this intensity of what we heard here to just, sink in and just try to feel, let it, get familiar with it. This is the practice. This is the essential practice. It's symbolized in the Mass. The Eucharist is like the unadulterated truth, is the pure, simple truth. The plain truth, the direct truth. Try to look at the direct truth. There is no duality, dualistic situation. There is no guilt. There's no need to resolve guilt. There's no reason to resolve what doesn't exist. Guilt and trying to resolve what exists is like leaven to bread. The Eucharist wafer is unleavened bread. Nothing's ever happened to that bread, you see? It's one instant, not two. So, and then the wine is the wow from hearing the truth. Jesus really told us, this is symbolizing what Jesus, the practice that Jesus wanted us to do. Hear the truth. And then full stop in the wow, because we will feel the wow for it. See, the wine gives you this, kind of a subtle wow feeling, okay? Subtle wow feeling. And then you're to sit quietly. The church is just going through the motions at this point. Really, after the Eucharist, the church should have a long period of silence, like 15 minutes, reinforce what's going on. Instead, they sit for silence for a couple minutes maybe, but it could be longer if you first to take the Eucharist, then you sit down and pray or whatever, and then it takes 10 or 15, 20 minutes for everybody else to go through it. So that can be helpful. But there really needs to be a longer period of silence. And of course, people don't even understand, they think they're getting the literal body and blood of Jesus. Transubstantiation, you are what you eat that's archaic, superstitious belief, But now Jesus was actually encoding. He kept trying to tell us, this is how you practice. Practice this way, okay? People hard for them to understand. And of course, people were illiterate back then. Many people were illiterate and continued to be for a long time. So they needed to kind of symbolize it in dramas, sort of stories. So the Mass is the way of it, really hidden in the Mass is, this teaching of full stop in the wow teaching, which we now have this up front and very clear and direct now. So this is a tremendous advancement upon the Roman Catholic Mass, actually. This is the pure format of it. The most intense, true practice of Jesus that Jesus wants us to practice. It's like a quantum leap beyond, the Roman Catholic Mass. Maybe some Catholics are ready for it. Maybe some Christians are ready for it. Maybe some people from all denominations are ready for it. Maybe some atheists are ready for it. Who's to say who's ready for it? Agnostics, you name it. It's all good. Whoever's ready for it is ready for it. It's just that plain and simple. You know, those who can do it, do. Those who can't, don't. You don't need to measure anyone. You know, don't need to measure it. It doesn't need measurement. How are we doing here? Pretty good, pretty good. Third time's the charm. You know, stay serious, don't be goofy. Don't be goofy. Managing the wow is a very serious business. It's the most serious business in the world, by far and away. Nothing is as serious as this, managing the wow. So, really, spiritual practice, you have to be very serious about it. This is not goofing off. This is not some social night out. This is not hookup culture. This is something that is very serious. And you need to approach it that way. Because you cannot allow the wow to run away with you. And because then you'll start, you know, coming undone. The wheels will start coming off. You have to take the practice very seriously. We must watch our mind very carefully, very determinedly. Don't allow any measurement to take place. Don't allow ourselves to go to the past, go to the present, go to the future, go sideways, go this way, go that way, go planning, strategizing, measuring, thinking, describing, defining, none of that stuff. This is I am now. And we may be shaking and trembling. Absolutely. Just let it be. Don't try to measure it. Don't try to express it. That's trying to put it into measurable format. And don't try to remember what was said to put you into the wow. That's again trying to put it back into measurable format. Once you're in the wow, you've exceeded measurement. You see, you the realization is wow. The now is not measurable. I am not measurable. We keep thinking we got to measure guilt to figure out how to get rid of it. You've got to measure the resolution of it. How much has been resolved? How well has it been resolved? There's no measurement. Reality can't be measured at all. There's nothing to measure. Now is immeasurable. It's always now. This is immeasurable. It's always this. This is I am now. Cricket's very persistent. It's been going all evening. That's kind of like we need to do. Why can't we be as persistent as a cricket? It's almost like it's consistent as a watch, as a clock, isn't it? I mean, it's unbelievable how constant that is. Chirp, 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 chirp. I mean, the intervals are like a Rolex. I never realized that before. Amazing. We won't measure it. Now we can get sidetracked because we think that the wow is going to be too strong. We feel, wow, we're getting so close, but it will be too strong. Well, we have to get back to the table and, and keep practicing. We have to, it's not too strong. It's not too strong. So somehow drag yourself into practicing every day, and every day you realize, wow, it wasn't too bad. It was intense, but it wasn't too much. This is why it's so important to practice every day, because it's easy to say, well, I'm not practicing because it's going to be too intense for me. You can always make that excuse. But if you do it, you find out it's not. If you don't do it, you can always assume that it is. So instead of thinking about, well, how do I need to measure this? Well, what form do I need to put it in? How do I express it? You don't have to worry about any of that. You don't need to express, don't need to say anything. Just stay quiet in the wow of it. So when the big boost arises, that what we need, it arrives, however, we'll know what to do. Just be quiet. And your mind is focused on the wow. I must avoid measurement. Let me not measure this. Let me not stray into measurement. How can you say this? It's like a prayer of keeping our balance. We're not. It's contemplation, effort to not lose our poise, our balance. Let me not stray. Let me just stay neutral. Let me not stray into measurement. It's kind of like you're watching yourself being very disciplined with your mind, disciplining your mind, saying, no, I will not allow any straying into measurement. This is different than trying to supplicate God, trying to ask something from God. God, help me, I'm so suffering so bad. Can't you do something for me? This guilt has really hurt me. Can't you resolve some of the guilt for me? Can't you resolve anything for me? I'm so sorry. That doesn't work. That doesn't work. How can God resolve what doesn't exist? That would be making the guilt real. I mean, God cannot get rid of, resolve the kind of stuff that we're trying to get rid of guilt. So, well, I'm suffering real bad here, God, and this is. I'm hoping it gets rid of guilt. Can you help me, get rid of guilt, this way? And no, you can't make lies true and then get rid of them. So it's what we need to do. It is not beg God. We're not beggars to God. We should not be beggars. I Actually, we're told that God appears as a beggar to us, begging us to stop begging. We don't need to beg, God. Nothing can be resolved because there isn't anything that needs resolution. I gave money to a beggar today. It was very interesting. I was like the first person at the stoplight. There was somebody there with a sign, homeless person. It was a very interesting person. They had some sign on their shirt, some sort of cross, of a insignia or something. And I gave money to him. As soon as I gave money to him, he hustled away across the street, and he had his bike there with like a basket or something, or some kind of basket, you know, or they had all his belongings or something. But he stopped. He stopped. As soon as I gave that, he rushed away and stopped begging. $1. I try to. You know, if you've been poor, you can relate to not having money. And so I know how it feels, and I say, hey, you know, anything helps. Just say, hey, you know, look, I understand your suffering, you know. I take it seriously. I always feel that poor people give more, you know, than a lot of, in some ways, and then rich people. It's hard for rich people to relate. They've always had a ton of money. They don't understand. You know, something wrong with your car. I said, well, just buy a new car. I mean, what's the problem? Or just get it fixed. Your car stopped working. Well, your tires are worn out. Well, get new tires. What's the matter with you? It's easy. You know, I'm smart. Rich people think they're smart because they know what to do. Buy something. Your tires wear out. Oh, yeah. I'm smart. Just go get a new pair of tires. And then the guy's going on the, you know, worn out tires and all this. And they say, well, stupid. You know, they don't even know how, don't even know they need to get new tires. That's stupid. No, it's not stupid. They don't have the money for it. You know, poor people are not stupid. But rich people automatically assume they're stupid. Yeah, I've experienced that. Not having any money in my life. There are times when I had to walk everywhere. And my car's broken, couldn't fix it. And, you know, people just, like, ignore me. Like, you know, they could tell, like, wow, this guy's, I mean, stupid. You know, why isn't he keeping up with, you know, doing what he doesn't realize he needs to do this. That's not that I didn't realize that. I didn't have any money to do it. And people didn't, they don't get it. They don't get it at all. Those who have money just simply don't get it. That, you know, they automatically assume that poor people are stupid. And that they're smarter. It's a big, big trouble. But as I've proven here, it's not the case at all, is it? The fact that we, you know, cannot buy things doesn't keep us from practicing full stop on the wow, doesn't. Nobody is prevented from practicing full stop on the wow. This is the most egalitarian situation in the world, right here. Equalitarian, egalitarian. Everybody, from rich to the poorest person on the planet, can practice this full stop on the wow. Equally, we're all equally qualified to do so. Don't have to buy anything to do it, really. To do this practice, you just sit. You can sit. You can lie down. You can sit. You can do it while leaning, standing if you want to, but it's probably easier. I recommend sitting. Allow truth to arise. You know, allow become aware of truth. When you're committed to quiet sitting, truth will arise for you because you're ready to handle it. You're willing to full stop in the wow. Go into neutral, take no measure of it. Jesus even said it's easier for poor people to do this because rich people are too busy proving how smart they are, thinking that, you know, the ability to buy stuff means they're smart. You know, they look at the yards, oh, you know, these people aren't very smart. Look at my yard, you know, I've installed this and this and this and this, and it's way smarter. Well, guess what? These people there, they didn't have the money to do that. So, it doesn't mean they're dumb. Maybe they've been spending their time practicing full stop on the wow. And then when the big boost arrives, they're able to handle it. They're able to practice this way. And then we'll find out who's been really smart. You know, we're going to find out who are the ones that are really smart. Those are the ones that have been practicing full stop on the wow. Yeah, I'm like a nobody to the rich people. Nobody, you know. They can't imagine, well, you know, why does he have a job like this? He's obviously he must not be smart enough to, you know. Of course, it takes money to go to school to capitalize your life, etc., right? And it takes a lot of different stuff. And it's not all about smarts. And again, the analogy like a car with worn out tires. Most people would see somebody who, you know, is dirty car, worn out tires. They say, oh, that, you know, wow, what an idiot. Why are they riding on worn out tires? That's stupid. Well, what's a new set of tires cost? Once they get it all, you know, the balance, installed, tax, disposal, on and on and on, about $600. You know, who has $600? To dispose of. Well, some people do, some people don't. But it is very vexatious to have people look at you and realize they're all looking at you like you're stupid. Very humiliating and humbling, you know, actually, when you know you're not stupid at all. But you're giving the appearance to the world that you are. That's a very humbling and vexatious feeling for sure. So I try to pretty much just stay away from the world. Yeah, they can't read the situation properly. Don't even bother to try and impress them in any way. It doesn't work. Just like when you go into a store. If they can, the people in the store, the proprietors can tell you you're there to spend money, you know, instantly you're a smart person. If you go in there and you don't have any money, you're instantly a stupid person to them. And I really experienced this in my life. When I was spending money I didn't really have, I wanted to test this out. And so I have for a brief while I would go in and I'd buy a bunch of stuff, you know. My gosh, the people would engage me like I was a brilliant person, and conversation, laughing. Wow, you're so witty. I mean, you're such a smart person, and, you know. And I thought, wow, these people really think I'm smart. That's great. Finally, I'm getting some validation. Then later on, I didn't have, you know, and run out of money. Didn't have any money. Couldn't spend any more. It's not possible, really. And all I could do was just go in there and, you know, window shop and look. But I went back to see my old friends and I wanted to chat. You know, I wanted to say, hey, you know, from one smart person to another person, how you doing today and stuff. They acted like they didn't even know me. Like I said, who's that stupid person over there? They're not buying anything. They must be stupid. said, what happened? I didn't quite realize, you know, just how cold-blooded is all this here. If you have money, you're smart. If you don't, you're stupid. That's the measure that we use. That's the measure that we use in society right now. It's unbelievable, isn't it? But it's true. I've experienced this through and through and through my entire life. If you have money, instantly other people will think you're smart. And they'll relate to you like you're smart. You're one of us. You're smart. Oh, I'm smart. You're smart. We're in the group of people. Smart people. We're smart. We know what to do. Sure. We know to jump on a plane and fly to there. We can fly to a conference. That's a smart thing to do. And the people aren't there. They're missing out. They're stupid. Why are they missing out? They're stupid. No, they can't afford it. So we have a society that is mismeasuring intelligence, actually, to an incredible extent. You know, it's like, why is this guy on YouTube? You know, well, I can't afford a website, that's why. I can't afford to pay for a website. I can get free websites, but they don't give you much bandwidth or you know, graphic, you know, storage space. But, you know, just assume, well, he's got nothing to say. He must be stupid. So, there's this terrible, you know, impasse. I try to get through it by running credit up on credit cards so people at least take me seriously, say, oh, he's smart because he's got money to spend. But I went into terrible debt because of that. And now that I'm not able to spend anything, you know, virtually nobody's listening. I go out in public, nobody pays me any regard or nothing. I can't, no traction. You know, this is how much we judge people according to their financial status in the world. Maybe I need like $1 billion, you know, poured on me, and then maybe people will listen. Say, wow, he's so smart. Look at that smart guy. Look at, he's buying this car. Wow, that's a nice purchase there. And it's a real smart purchase. Could have gotten this, but he got that instead. That's really smart. Everybody, when you have $1 billion, then everybody in the world will run to your door and say, wow, you know, I have such a privilege to meet such an intelligent person. And we have this charity. We think that would really enhance your portfolio of brilliance. You know, everyone in the world comes out of the woodwork asking for money. And, you know, I would say, hey, look, I was just as smart yesterday as I am today with $1 billion. I was just as smart with not a penny as I am today with $1 billion. Where were you praising my intelligence when I didn't have a penny? You were nowhere to be found. So I would say you're just using money as a measure of intelligence, which is totally false. You're not going to ever succeed wisdom-wise that way. The same thing with relationships. People just look at you like, oh, you're a loser. You must be stupid. No, there's all sorts of stuff that can happen. Like I told you, like I've said in this video, my life got turned upside down. The shock is still there when I realized that nothing can be resolved. Death doesn't resolve anything. I've been put under incredible stress and strain. You know, broke my health, you know, nerves, my health. I can't, I have no confidence. I cannot, you know, I cannot function well. But is this stupidity or is this just tremendous challenge? The challenge is so severe that I appear to be floundering, you know. But now people are blind to it, absolutely blind to it. Nobody takes a moment. This is what I discovered. Nobody takes a moment to drop the knee-jerk reaction. Like, who is this? I meet people, rich people all the time. They never take a moment to, so who is this? I mean, to get to know me at all. You just say, well, what's your money status? Oh, okay, I know you then. I got it. They have to validate their own smartness. Oh, I got it. Here's this guy doesn't have money. He's stupid. Okay, have a nice day. Of course, they're nice to you, but you know, it's like, wow, you're just not in our class. How can I tell them? You know, it's the opposite. Who's really smart? You see, like, how can you tell them? They think you're just being impertinent. You know, really arrogant. Jesus said it's harder for a rich person to get in the kingdom of heaven than it is for a camel to go through the eye of a needle. And maybe this part of the situation, they assume that they're smart. So I'm smart, so I'm okay. I'm able to take the measure of things, you know. How can you take the measure of now? So they avoid it. They say, well, I'll be stupid. I won't be able to measure it. And, well, people think I'm stupid. So they avoid it. So how wise is that? Poor person says, what I got to lose? I got no status to lose anyway. I might as well, you know, realize I'm totally incompetent and dumb. I can't measure now. And well, I have to accept that. Final humiliation. You know, I can't measure at all. Completely stupid. That's why I say, practice, say, yes, I am completely stupid. Yes, I am that total stupidity. I am that perfect stupidity. Absolutely, I am. So, what's your status? Well, I am that perfect stupidity. Well, what? Yeah, I am that perfect stupidity. How are we doing in the video? Great. You know, this is a great accomplishment. We got it done. It's almost midnight. I did two videos again to start out with, and neither one of them I realized, uh-oh, this is not quite going the way that it needs to go. That doesn't usually happen. But this one was a tough one, you know, to get into. It's tough to get back on track like in this way, you know, and drop the bar fight stuff. Gotta drop the bar fight stuff. So yes, I am that perfect stupidity. I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect failure. This is I am now. This is I am now. That's all I know, that this is I am now. That's it. I don't know anything else. Yeah, I am that perfect idiot. I'm not an imperfect idiot. I'm a perfect idiot. I am that perfect idiot. This is really the way we need to do it, because you cannot turn the tables on society. Really, you cannot. It's just the way it's structured. No, it's just not possible. So you know you have to agree with your adversary. Say, I am that perfect idiot. But you might say, yeah, I'm that perfect idiot you've been looking for. You can't expect people to completely drop right off the bat the measure of their success. You know, it doesn't happen that way. People get rich because they're obsessed with measuring their success. You know, they're trying to measure how well they can resolve stuff. And so you cannot expect them. You just have to say, yeah, I am that perfect idiot you've been looking for. I am that perfect failure that you've been looking for your whole life. Instead of saying, I am that perfect success you've been looking for your whole life. You know, no. I am that perfect failure that you've been looking for your entire life. And they say, oh yeah, what kind of failure? You say, well, nothing can ever be resolved. I didn't resolve anything. I realized nothing can be resolved. And that's okay, because there isn't anything that needs to be resolved. They may say, huh. This is kind of interesting. You know, it didn't attack my status or try to, you know, but I am that perfect failure. Oh, very great. This has gone well. Very, 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 gone very well. So, we've done good work, and you just have to trust it. You know, it will carry over, and we get used to the wow of this, and then next time we go, you know, take quite a leap, you know, greater leap into it. But not right now. Just let this wow mellow out. Was that commercial? We love hot dogs, ice cream, apple pie, and Chevrolet. Yeah. That's summertime, right? We love hot dogs, ice cream, apple pie, and Chevrolet. Right. Maybe I'll try the next hot dog without any mustard. I'm sorry, without any ketchup. I'll try without any ketchup. No ketchup on the hot dog next time. Just a double dose of mustard. Ketchup is for the hamburgers. I made a faux pas. It's a faux pas. You know, must be stupid. I made a faux pas. Put ketchup on. He puts ketchup on his hot dog? My gosh, that's stupid. Yeah, I am that perfect idiot you've been looking for. Absolutely, I am that perfect idiot you've been looking for. I've always been that perfect idiot you've been looking for. I can't be anything other than that perfect idiot you've always been looking for. I am that perfect failure you've been looking for. Yes, I am that perfect failure. All right. Better than the bar fight here, isn't it? This is better than the bar fight. Keep in mind, this is better than the bar fight here. No doubt about it. It may be the only thing that's better than the bar fight, but it is better than the bar fight. Here you get to see, you know, you get to hear from the perfect failure. That which is the perfect failure. Perfect failure. Okay. That's enough for this one.